when I was working in chemical industry or when I was doing reactions for my PhD degree. I'm most worried when the reactions go very slow or when reaction doesn't work. Because without completing the ongoing reaction, my boss has never ever allowed me to do a next reaction. If the reactions are not working, or if the reaction is going very slow, we never used to throw the reaction mass into the sink. Instead, on those days, to speed up the reaction, the first choice is to increase the temperature by heating. During this time, I have done many reactions which involve temperature above 250 degrees C. At the moment, when you go beyond a temperature of 250 degrees C, the region where I'm doing reactions or the region where I'm working, it's going to turn hot. In fact, it is smoking hot. Hence, the disadvantage is too hot to handle the reaction. Other disadvantages are, to heat, we should use heating mantle, electrical devices. They are very sensitive at high temperature, and many of the times these devices has caught fire. The next choice is to pressurize the reaction. If the reaction is to be pressurized, you need to close the container completely before heating it, or use power shaker vessel, which is a glass vessel used for doing pressurized reactions. Or we can use autoclave vessels, but in all these cases, disadvantage is at any point of time, you may end up with an explosion. Then the third choice is add some chemicals which can accelerate the reaction. But here, the problem comes in the form of purification of the product formed. Assume I have added a chemical X to the reaction. Let's hope its presence made the reaction to go to completion. But here, along with product, so many side products plus X will remain in the reaction mass. In this case, purification of the product formed will be a challenging job. Apart from this, there are so many choices. Out of it, the best choice is irradiating it to a microwave. But the disadvantage of microwave is that it restricts you to do only a small scale reactions. The last choice is a beautiful choice, that is using catalyst. Using catalyst is very cool idea, but many of the catalysts which I've heard and which I've come across are very, very costly. Still, catalysts are required in very small quantity, and it have done tremendous revolution in chemical industry, hence under surface chemistry. Today's center of attraction is catalysis. Under catalysis, we are planning to know about catalysis and type of catalysis, adsorption theory of heterogeneous catalysis, shape selective catalysis, enzyme catalysis, catalysis in industry. The scientist on the screen is Johns Jacob Berzelius, who has proposed vital force theory. He was doing a reaction in the lab, that is decomposition of potassium chlorate. When Berzelius heated potassium chlorate strongly, it was slowly undergoing for a decomposition to give dioxygen at 653 to 873 Kelvin. It is, in fact, according to me, huge temperature. However, when a little amount of MnO2 is added to the same reaction, decomposition was taking place at a temperature range of 473 to 633 Kelvin. What a magical one. There is a drop in 200 Kelvin temperature. Moreover, he noticed that added manganese dioxide remained unchanged with respect to mass and composition. In the similar way, Berzelius started trying many reactions with addition of different chemicals. The systematic study of the effect of various chemical substances on the rate of chemical reaction was studied by Berzelius continuously for years together. With the result of this, in 1835, he suggested the term catalyst for the substances which is used to accelerate the reactions. Based on all the experiments Berzelius has done, finally he has come up with the definition of a catalyst as a substance which alters the rate of a chemical reaction without undergoing for a chemical change in terms of mass as well as in terms of a composition. And this phenomenon is called as catalysis. Let us learn about catalytic promoters and catalytic poisons. Catalytic promoter is a substance which increases the activity of a catalyst, whereas catalytic poison is a substance that decreases the activity of a catalyst. Moving on, we have catalytic promoters and catalytic poisons. Let us analyze how these things work. Assume a preparation of ammonia by Haber process. In this reaction, Fe is a catalyst. And if you use MO, that is molybdenum, it acts as a catalytic promoter. In case if you use CO, then the scenario is different. CO is going to decrease the rate of formation of ammonia. That is, CO is going to act as a catalytic poison. Types of catalysis. There are two types of catalysis. One is homogeneous catalysis, and the second one is heterogeneous catalysis. Homogeneous catalysis, in which HOMO stands for same. If all the reactants involved in the reaction and the catalyst present in the same phase, then they are called as homogeneous catalysis. Examples for homogeneous catalysis. The first example is oxidation of sulfur dioxide into sulfur trioxide. We all know that sulfur dioxide and oxygen are going to be in a gaseous phase. Since the catalyst we use is nitric oxide, which is also a gas, hence it is going to be an example for homogeneous catalysis. The second example is hydrolysis of methyl acetate catalyzed by an acid. The acid may be HCl or H2SO4. Here in this reaction, we have a methyl acetate, which is a liquid, and then H2O, which is a liquid. Along with that, we are expecting a product to be a liquid. In fact, it is going to be a liquid, maybe a HCl or H2SO4. Any of them will work for this reaction. Both of them will be present in the liquid phase. The third example is hydrolysis of sugar, which is catalyzed by acid. Now we have a sucrose in an aqueous medium. Water is a liquid, and the catalyst which we are going to use H2SO4, which is also a liquid. Next, we have to look into heterogeneous catalysis. If the reactants and catalysts are present in the different phases, then it should be called as heterogeneous catalysis. Let us analyze few examples for this heterogeneous catalysis. The first one is oxidation of sulfur dioxide. Here I have a sulfur dioxide, which is in a gaseous state. O2 is a gas. The catalyst is going to be V2O5, that is vanadium pentoxide. It is present in the solid phase, hence it is an example for heterogeneous catalysis. The next example is preparation of ammonia by Haber's process. N2 is a gas, H2 is a gas, and the catalyst for this reaction is either FeO or Fe. Both of them are present in the solid phase. Hence, it is also an example for heterogeneous catalysis. Number 3, Ostwald's process. The first step of Ostwald process involves ammonia, which is a gas, oxygen, which is a gas, and the catalyst which we use here is either rhodium or platinum. Both of them are present in the solid state. Hence, it is an example for heterogeneous catalysis. Number 4 is hydrogenation of vegetable oil. So vegetable oil is a liquid, H2 is a gas. Here nickel is going to act as a catalyst. Since it is present in a solid state, this is yet another example for heterogeneous catalysis. The next subtopic of interest is adsorption theory of heterogeneous catalysis. It has two versions. The first version is Wold adsorption theory, and the second version is modern adsorption theory. According to Wold adsorption theory, when reactants start adsorbing on the surfaces of the catalyst, concentration of the reactant on the surface of the catalyst increases. Hence, rate of reaction increases. Since adsorption is an exothermic process, heat liberated during this process is used in further increment of rate of reaction. While modern adsorption theory is the combination of intermediate compound formation theory and old adsorption theory. Based on modern adsorption theory, there are 5 steps in which reaction occurs. The first step is diffusing in of reactant molecules to the surface of the catalyst. That is, reactant molecules will reach the surface of the catalyst very slowly. And the second point is that adsorption of a reactant molecules takes place on the surface of the catalyst. Moreover, this theory says that the active sites or free valencies of a catalyst are present only on the surface. And the third step is that the adsorbed reactant molecule will undergo for a reaction through the intermediate formation. Once it's done, desorption of the product molecules takes place. Once the desorption is done, diffusing out of the reaction products will take place, so that there will be an empty space for a further set of reactants to come and to form an intermediate and then to lead to a product, and they will get out from the surface of the catalyst. This is how set by set the reactant molecules will come onto the surface of the catalyst. They will undergo for a reaction. They will form a product. Let us analyze the mechanism of modern adsorption theory. There are so many valencies on the surface of the catalyst that I'll mark now. So these are all called as free valencies. A and B are the reactants. They are diffused into the catalyst surface. Now, A and B have got adsorbed to the free valencies of the catalyst, which is present on the surface. It is a free valency for which A has got attached. It is one of the reactant, and B is another reactant which also has got attached. Next, A and B forms an intermediate, meaning A is one reactant and B is another reactant. Both of them have started reacting with each other and it has formed an high energy intermediate. When the intermediate breaks, it gives a product AB, and moreover, once the reaction is done, your catalyst free valencies are left empty, meaning next set of reactant molecules AB will come to the same place. They will get adsorbed here, they will do the reaction, and again it produces a product AB. Catalyst work by lowering the activation energy, hence it increases the rate of reaction, and moreover catalyst will always proceed with a different mechanism. Let us move on to an example of modern adsorption theory, wherein I have a solid surface of catalyst in which the red colored ones are called active sites, or say free valencies, and this molecule is ethene, that is CH2 CH2, and in specific we are going to check how the mechanism of adsorption occurs with respect to hydrogenation of alkene. And here is a hydrogen. Both of them have got diffused in and they have got adsorbed to the surface of the catalyst. After that, what happens is, say, they will start reacting with each other. Once they complete the reaction through a intermediate, the product will form, and now that is slowly going away from the free valencies as a product. So once it starts, it indicates that the formed product is undergoing for a desorption and it comes out of the surface to form a molecule called ethane. So in this mechanism we have seen how your ethene get adsorbed to the surface along with hydrogen to form a molecule of ethane. Uniqueness of modern adsorption theory is that it can nicely explain why the mass of the catalyst remains unchanged, and moreover it very clearly explains that why the chemical composition of a catalyst is not changing. The only limitation of modern adsorption theory is that it cannot explain the action of catalytic promoters and it cannot explain the action of catalytic poisons.